perfect stranger about to be born into darkness, sadness, desperate madness, creation so torn. We were so lost on earth, no peace, no worth, no way to escape, and fear, no faith, no hope, no grace, and no light, but that was the night before Christmas. Warm hay, cold sweat, a mother not yet, praying Godspeed the dawn. She looks to her men, holding her hand, they wonder how long. And the shepherds, wise men, come to find them and bow to a king. One star above, shining on love, so bright, it lit up the night before Christmas.
Welcome. Go ahead and find your way in. There's plenty of seating this morning. People are, Carson, get your feet off there. We're terrified of snow in Kansas. Not really. We're terrified of people driving on snow. That's what I'm terrified of. I am not scared of my own driving. I'm terrified of other people. I probably should be scared of my own driving. I'm really not the world's best driver. You can look at my truck, and it's hard for me to deny that I'm really not a good driver. I've always wanted to be a good driver. I'm just really not. Huh? My kids' cars? Yeah, I tend to hit the Roberts cars, no matter where they are. I think I've dented 2 out of 3 of them. Yeah. They keep them like shrines. That's where Pastor Casey hit my car. Where did he hit your car? Well, don't park behind me, okay? That's all I'm saying. Don't park behind me. I'm glad you're here today, and I do pray that you are able to come and put aside all of the stuff that can distract us and engage in worship. And that's why we're here, and we're going to pray and ask God to just bless the time, and I hope that you have a beautiful, beautiful Sunday afternoon and that you drive safely home when we're done, all right? Pray for the other people around you. They're the ones that slide always. The people in front of me start sliding. All right? Hey, let's pray together. God, thank you so much for letting us be here today. And God, I'm just glad the fact that we get to be here. And we're not here because we have to be. Teach us more and more of what that is about as a congregation, that it is our joy and privilege to be with each other and be with you. And I pray that you'd give us an atmosphere of celebration, an atmosphere of joy and worship, so that we could honor the name of Jesus and celebrate our relationship with Him tremendously today, authentically. Pray that you would bless the music and the message for your honor and glory and for our blessing and for our inspiration, God. I pray that you would help us to stay focused on the birth of Jesus, our Savior, and what that means through this season. And I ask you to bless this service. We give it to you today in Jesus' great name. Amen. Would you stand and greet each other, and we'll have the children come up in just a minute for the children's message.
Adults, if you would be seated as our children make their way down front.
Can I have y'all scoot down here so I can see your cute little faces? All right. You got to turn around and face me, though, for that to happen. All right. It's only a couple days until Christmas.
Two,
exactly. Yeah, two. And how many hours and minutes is it until? No, don't worry about that. But you know, it's exciting to get gifts, isn't it? I think that's a really cool thing that people love us.
I bought two presents for Ray, and he brought one.
You did? Wonderful. It is fun to get gifts. And it's fun because people who love us give us things, and they want to bless us. And when you're your age, you know, I just want you to know it's okay. We all get excited about presents under the tree and people giving us gifts. And we all know, I think that we would know, that it is important to remember that Jesus is the one who gave us the greatest gift. And he gave us salvation. He gave us a home in heaven. And the Bible does say this. It says that it is better. It actually says blessed. It is more blessed to give than to receive. And that means happy. You'll grow into this, but one day it will be more fun for you to give gifts than to receive. And God is the greatest giver in the world. He has given us everything. The Bible says how God is so good that he gave us his own son. So if he gave us his own son, Jesus, what would God not be willing to give us? There's nothing. If he gave us his best, there's nothing he wouldn't be willing to give us in addition to that. So, here's what I want you to do this Christmas. As you give and receive gifts to other people that you love, I want each one to remind you that God has given you the best gift ever. And I want you to be excited about those gifts that you get. Be sure to say thank you. Send a note if people don't live close to you, or give them a phone call. But as you get those gifts and you receive them and you're excited about it, just let every one of them, every single gift, remind you that God gave you Jesus first, okay? That's why we really should exchange gifts, is to remind us of that, that God gave us everything that we needed so that one day we get to go to heaven, a place that is so beautiful, so glorious, and there will be no more crying in heaven, no more hurts, no more sadness, no more dark nights, nothing scary, nothing bad at all. That's the gift God has given us, and we get to live. Everything is happy. Not just some things, but everything. You're right. And healthy. Is that a match? I would like that too. I love it. I would like that, he said very seriously. Like, I don't know if y'all are getting this, but I would like that. I would too. Yes, ma'am.
We also don't have to eat and drink in heaven.
Because we won't have to, but we might get to, but we won't have to.
That's
okay.
Yeah. If that's our little family for Christmas.
Is what?
My mommy. And my daddy, and me, and my brother.
Oh, that's a wonderful family together on Christmas. Guys, I hope y'all have a great one, and I hope we get to see you back on Christmas Eve if you get to come. If not, I hope you have a merry, merry Christmas, and that you enjoy the gift that God's given you. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for our children. Would you bless them today? Help them to know how important they are to this church family, how loved they are, how special they are to you. Jesus, remind them that when the children came to you, you welcomed them, Jesus. You put your arm around them and called them to you, and you loved them, and you used them as examples of what it means to have a pure, honest faith. And I pray that our children would have that too, and that you would let us as a church honor them and bless them and love them. We love you. Thank you for Christmas. for all that it means to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys.
Let's all stand and worship. It's Christmas time. We got to praise him. Aren't you glad he came? I'm so glad he came. Last week, Casey preached about the cave that Christ was born in. And I said a minute ago that I'm so grateful that he came. And it's easy to forget that he was a king, man. He was the King of Kings. And he left all that splendor for us. He didn't have to, but he chose to because he loved us. That's powerful to me.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, all so highly exalted, glorious than created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Sing that again.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful.
Once more without the instruments.
And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And here I am to worship.
Father, we do praise and adore you this morning as you made a choice to come and live among us, God, to make a way through Jesus Christ for us to have a relationship with you. And let us not overlook that today. Lord, help us to be grateful for it. Help us to enjoy it and to find security in it, to find love and peace and all those things, Lord, that you are in this relationship. And help us to grow. And God, as our pastor comes forward here in just a moment, I pray that you would speak through him. God, use him, fill him with your Holy Spirit. And I pray the words, Lord, that come out are words that we need to hear. And God, help us to apply them to our lives so when we walk out of here today, when we can be all those things, peaceful and loving, and do all those things we need to be doing to live your word out. And God, we're going to praise you for what you're going to do. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, guys. Wow, y'all slid in here, didn't you? Parking lot doing okay? Is what it is. Thanks, Scott, for pushing it off for us. Hey, this past weekend, this past Wednesday morning, I had this incredible privilege. It won't sound like a privilege, but it really was, of sitting with Halverson's family as they said goodbye to their precious mother and grandmother. Probably not many people feel like it's a blessing to sit in an ICU unit, but there were probably 15 family members there. It was filled with siblings and cousins and aunts and uncles, mothers and sisters, brothers, all of that. And they walked this precious lady right to the very door of heaven. And again, as my experience as a hospice chaplain, I've seen this take place a lot, but I don't know that I've ever seen it take place quite so beautifully. Marie Brockstrom had one of the most beautiful escorts from this life into the next that I've probably ever been a part of. There was very seldom a time, if ever, in fact, I couldn't remember a time in 4 hours that I was sitting there, that somebody wasn't holding her hand, stroking her hair, getting her something, wetting her mouth. She sat there on life support. Words of reassurance whispered into her ear. And when all of the life support measures were removed, she slipped as peacefully from this life into the eternity with Jesus that I maybe have ever seen take place. And I just, all the while being loved on, all the while being cared for with a tenderness and a compassion and a grace that was just no other way to say it. It was beautiful. And I think that it's sometimes important to see that transition as nothing more than a transition and nothing less than a transition. I prayed a lot as I stood in the corner of that crowded ICU room, and it was a crowded ICU room. And I just prayed for peace to fill people's hearts and lives, and it was really kind of cool to see there would be ebbs and flow, tides coming in and out of joy and you know, remembrance, and then there would be waves of sadness and grief, and it would just kind of come and it would go, and people would respond, they would love on each other, love her, and it was really the best send-off into heaven that I've ever been a part of, and I felt very, very privileged. I literally got to watch, as, think about it like this, and this is what I was thinking of. It's easier when you're not a part of the family to do this, but I thought any moment when they remove life support, we get to watch as a lady sees Jesus. We didn't get to see what she got to see, but we were there when she saw it. And so from one transition to the other, it was the most incredible thing. She inherited salvation while we stood there. I remember sitting in the very corner by the sink thinking, this lady is about to inherit salvation fully, completely. An amazing moment and a tremendous privilege to be there as she took hold of what had been purchased for her over 2,000 years ago. It was awesome. Scott, your family did a great job. It was beautiful to be there. Thank you for letting me be there. As we approach this last week in this month-long series called The Celebration That Should Be, I feel like particularly blessed to have had that experience. Doesn't, again, sounds a little counterintuitive to say I feel blessed to be a part of someone leaving this life, but I really didn't see it as someone leaving this life nearly as much as I felt like I was there when someone inherited true life. I thought about her salvation that day, about Marie's, and I thought a lot about mine. And you know, there was no greater gift Marie Brockstrom ever received in her life than Jesus. And I listened to people as they talked, and no one was having side conversations like, I wonder if she's making it to heaven. I wonder if she's been good enough. I wonder if she's done this. I wonder if she's done that. No one was having that. No one was wondering about that. There was there was just a certainty there, and there was just no greater gift. And she gave that gift back, right? Because those people in that room got the gift of the assurance of knowing that this is not the end. This is not the end. Death has not won in her life. And she was giving that back to them. And as everybody sat with this reassurance and this calm, tender grief, but it was intermingled with joy and hope and assurance. And it was just beautiful. It was awesome, in fact. It was awe-inspiring. Because heaven can't be earned, right? It would have been a tragic thing for somebody to think, I wonder where the scales were for her. Did she do more good than bad? Probably this lady did. I didn't know her very well at all, but probably she did. But the Bible says that didn't matter anyway. You can't earn it. Can't get into heaven by your good works or your good deeds or your self-righteousness. No one can do it. And there was that would leave everybody in this moment of speculation and uncertainty when it's already hard enough, right? When you lose somebody you love, the last thing you want to know is where are they going to be when they cross over into this next life? Awesome. Heaven can't be earned and sin can't be paid for by good works. Spiritual death brought on by our own sin against God can't be overcome by good works or moral behavior. And if you've never been able to witness the impact of that in a real life situation where someone's facing eternity, it is an amazing thing to see assurance of salvation capture not only an individual but a group and to sweep its way through there. It was beautiful. Salvation is a gift, and a gift that we receive, but it's also a gift that spreads out into the people that we love, who walk with us through life, and in this situation, walk with us right to the very gates of heaven. And the only thing a person can do to this salvation, just receive it. That's all you can do. Just receive it. Take it into your life. And once a person receives that gift, they can't even give it back. You can't. It's non-refundable. And that's something to celebrate this Christmas. So I ask you these two questions. First of all, can we, not just in these moments where we have these real powerful, profound spiritual moments of enlightenment and truth and realization, but can you and I, on a day-to-day basis, learn to live in celebration of our salvation? Can we live kind of a day-to-day? I'm not talking about it being on an emotional high all the time. I'm just talking, can we live with a constancy to our salvation and a realization of this enormous gift that became so real to me? Listen, I've been there before. I've been there with my own family members as they inherited salvation, but something was a little new and fresh, and probably because I wasn't as close to the individual, and I could observe it in the lives of the people around me and hear these things going on in my head and talk to the Father about it. Can we learn to live in celebration of our salvation? And if the answer is that is yes, and I will propose that it is, how do we do that? Because do you have to just fake it until you make it? Do you just have to act a certain way? How do you learn to live in a constant state of celebration? Now, if you think of celebration as a birthday party and you're blowing the horns and you're throwing confetti or whatever, well, that's not what I'm really referring to. I'm talking about in the joy and the anticipation and the eager hope that we have. Can that embed itself in our life? Can we live with that? This week in story. And we're talking about the Bible from a narrative perspective. Narrative, just another word for story. From a story perspective. This week, we're going to look at it from the perspective of the birth forward to the angels revealing the birth to the shepherds. So we've been kind of walking through this story phase by phase by phase. And we're trying to experience it, not just hear it. I want you to know that's my prayer for you and my hope that when you come, you don't just hear the story, that you somehow enter into it. So give yourself the freedom to do that, to imagine and to allow the Holy Spirit of God to lead you into the mix of the story, to see it as if you were there firsthand, to somehow imagine it in a way that it brings it to life, that you could almost smell the smells and hear the sounds and experience the emotions almost firsthand. That would be a profound gift, and I pray that you would be open to feeling that, if God would be so great to lead us into that. And this set of the story, this phase, picks up with Joseph and Mary in Bethlehem, and they found shelter in a cave, okay? There was no room in the inn, right? So we've got Mary and Joseph in a manger or a shelter place for animals. She's in labor. And there they are. Pray with me as we proceed. God, right now we need your voice to become absolutely clear to us. Walk with us through this story, God, in a way that it's more than a story. It's not a fictional story. It's history. It's your story. It's truth, and it's revealed to us. And I pray that you would capture us with it today. God, sweep us away with it. This truth, this reality, this event, this fact that happened 2,000 years ago, that all of the stores and all of the schools and all of the society, even our government and our highest officials, are recognizing something about this today and in this week to come. That says it's monumental. It sent shockwaves through history, forward and backwards. And we want to look into it closely today. Give us eyes to see and faith to believe. In the powerful name of Jesus, we ask. Amen. I tried this week to imagine more. And, part of sounds kind of like you might be overpaying a guy who sits in his office and imagines. But I do. I really do. I sit there and I read the text and I try to imagine. What was that like for Joseph and Mary to be there? What did they feel when the first shockwaves of labor captured her and sent shivers of pain through her? Did Joseph hurt for her? Was he a tender, compassionate husband? Or is he kind of like me my first time through? I was sitting on a stool like this, and Kelly is in the bed next to me, and I was a rookie, okay? Just bear with me. And I think I've confessed this before. But I'm the one that's sitting there, and I was a couple hours, and I'm watching the monitors, and I realized, man, sitting on a stool is not that comfortable. And I said that out loud. I said, like, man, my back's hurting from this stool. And my wife's going through labor. I'm sorry. I apologize again. That sounds worse every time I tell that. Golly. That's where you do the loser thing. I never know which way that goes. See, that makes you a real loser if you don't know which way the L goes, right? I did that. What was Joseph doing? I don't know. I don't know if he was over there like terrified, going, God, what in the world's going on? And Mary's going, Joseph, get over here. I need some ice chips or what? I mean, no, of course there are no ice chips. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to imagine what it was like. What was he feeling? What was he thinking? And then if you just fast forward through all of that and you have a baby, she goes through labor and there's a baby that is born and Mary's okay. Joseph may have passed out once or twice. We don't know, but he's okay. And the baby's all right, and they wrap him up in swaddling clothes, and there they are in this dark cave with animals and straw and hay and bewilderment and excitement and thrill and all of this stuff. Can you imagine? There's the King of Kings, the Creator of the world. The Colossians says, by Him and through Him, all things were created. Nothing was created except through Jesus. And there He is, swaddled up in linens, held closely to His mother, or laid in that feed trough full of hay. There's the King entering the world. It's hard to imagine. It's hard to imagine what people were thinking or feeling, experiencing. But soon enough, this baby is born. He's there, and he's all is good. And then this story transitions quite abruptly to the shepherds outside of Bethlehem. It's important to know something about shepherds in Jesus' day. Maybe you know this. But they were not noble men. They were not thought of as noble men. They didn't have good reputations. Back in King David's day, they did, as David was a shepherd boy, right? So we kind of get stuck in the pre-Jesus day of shepherding, where shepherd was a family tradition. It was passed along from generation to generation. But in Jesus' day, somewhere it had transitioned, and shepherds had bad reputations. They were known as the rough side of town kind of folks. They overgrazed pastures. They tended to kind of be free range mentality, where, you know, my sheep need grass and it's not mine, I'll let them eat it anyway. They were known to be thieves. They were known to be crude, and some probably deserved the reputation, and obviously some didn't. But that was the reputation. They were not noblemen. All right, they weren't. You know, when we look at a nativity set and you see the shepherds, and they look like such kind gentlemen, so holding their staff and taking care of their little sheep. And maybe they were, but that's not how the world saw them back then. So we say that because it is surprising if you were to read the story for the first time and know nothing. If you knew the culture and knew what was going on, you read the story and you say God showed up to the shepherds first, that would make no sense. That would be shocking to the mind of a first century listener or hearer of this story. It would not make any, it would be confounding. But here they are, the shepherds, hearing from God. An angel shows up, right? An angel keeps showing up in this story, doesn't it? I mean, from the very beginning, to Mary and Joseph, to Elizabeth and Zechariah, and now to these shepherds, an angel shows up. Obviously, they were terrified by the event, just like the people were before. Every one of them was terrified, weren't they? Do you remember that? The angel almost every time has to say, what? Don't be afraid. But that's an important thing, because it is obviously outside the realm of normality. It's not something they were expecting. If you were talking to an angelic being, I think you and I would be afraid too. And the angel shows up, tells the shepherds, Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. They weren't going to hear a message of doom. I imagine that's probably what they were thinking, is that, you know, we're so despised by the religious community of our day. If this is an angel of God, it can't be good news for us. Maybe they're coming to confirm what everybody says about us. Maybe they're coming to usher in judgment. They weren't sitting around thinking we might be the first recipients of the news of the Messiah being born. They were not thinking that. So they're terrified, but the angel alleviates their fears and tells them that he's bringing them good news of great joy for all the people. Now, all the people is an important phrase in there, because here's the mystery and the beauty of God's design and how he unveils this salvation that we're talking about through Christmas, is that God does not start with the higher-ups. He doesn't start with government officials and nobility and kings and governors. He doesn't start with high priests and the religious figures of the day. He doesn't start up here. He starts way down here in the proclamation of the coming of Jesus. The salvation, the gift that's being ushered in, is being ushered in at the lowest level possible. So it sweeps its way through, all the way through. If it starts up here, the people down here, and this is, I'm speaking in how they structure themselves, not how we would see this today. But if they start up here, if God says, I go to the high priest, if I go to the governor, if I go to the Roman emperor, then these people are never going to think. It doesn't trickle down. It's never going to get to them. It's for the religious elite. But if it starts down here, then it sweeps everybody into the story. And so the shepherds are swept in to the story. And he says this, the angel goes on to say these words that are so staggering it had to confound the shepherds initially. And I want to tell you this today. If you read this as a story that literally happened, an event that literally occurred, and you somehow entered into this, the culture and the mindset and the mood of that moment, these words would be staggering to you. They would leave you breathless. You ever gotten news like that? Either good or bad? Where it just felt like it sucked all the wind out of you. It was so exciting or so grief-stricken. This news would hit them like that, only in a good way. It says, today, this very day, not someday, today, right now, immediate, this has already occurred, in the city of David, there has been born. It's already a done deal. It's already taken place for you, the shepherds. It's for you. The gift, they're recipients of it. They've been embraced by it. They've been included. This is not normal stuff for shepherds to hear. Today, in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior. Now, I do not like religious ease or church lingo, because it alienates people, and a lot of times I don't even understand it. Okay? So throwing around words like Savior sounds kind of, you know, we miss it. For one thing, we're so familiar with that term, and we're so used to being familiar with the term that we don't really understand or look into, that we'd lose its impact. But if you were a shepherd in that day, and you had enough knowledge, which they did, to understand Savior and then what would follow this terminology, this news just keeps getting more and more staggering. There is today already been born for them a Savior. The word is soter, and it means one who comes. It's a general term. It's not specifically a religious term, the word Savior. And it has in general meaning of someone who comes to rescue or save or to bring in goodness and peace and to bring people through a bad time to a much better time of prosperity and hope. It's kind of like our word hero, but it's a lot more powerful than that. Especially today when we use the word hero loosely. But that's as close as we would probably get. So he says, today in the city of David, there's been born for you a Savior who is, now they're going to describe, now he's going to say who the Savior, who is Christ the Lord. They would understand that in a powerful way. Christ is the word we translate as Messiah. They understood Messiah to be one given by God who would save Israel, who'd lead them into a new day, that would bring a dawning of hope and restoration to the nation of Israel. And yes, there's lots of confusion about what the Messiah would look like and what he would do, because some thought he would be a political Messiah, some thought he'd be a military type Messiah, and then a precious few knew that he would be a spiritual Messiah whose kingdom would not be of this world and would ultimately be saving us out of the world system into a brand new hope of redemption and true salvation. I don't know what the shepherds thought when they heard this Savior is Christ, the Messiah, the Lord. I don't know how they interpreted that, but I do know they knew it was monumental. Think about it like this. The only way we can wrap our minds around this is this. You and I all believe that one day, factually, theologically, biblically, Jesus is coming back, right? We get that. You all know that? Do you agree? Jesus is coming back. That's what the Bible says. So we should know that. But we live with like the 10 o'clock news is coming on too, right? We know that. And we kind of go, oh yeah, Jesus is coming back. And in the back of your mind, you're going, but that's not going to happen in my lifetime. I believe it, but I can't imagine it. Can you imagine? This news is just like that to them. All right, we're thinking if someone came in here and said, Jesus has come today in the city of Kansas City, your Savior has returned. Jesus is back. First of all, we'd probably say, Wally, could somebody with handcuffs get this person out of here? Because we're, Can you imagine? I mean, seriously, get into their world. An angelic being, a bright, bright light, glory. Are they dreaming this? The Messiah has been born? Really? And I'm included? I'm a part? You're talking to me? I mean, I would think that would be pretty amazing if someone came and told me Jesus was back and he was back for me. I believe that. Listen, I believe with all of my heart Jesus is returning to this earth to bring those who are in him with him. He said that where he would be, one day we would all be with him. And I believe that, but I cannot tell you that I can really imagine it. I mean, that's beyond my capability, my scope. And here are shepherds, common men, hearing news just like that. Out of all the people in the world, all the priests, all the kings, all the governors, all the religious leaders, the myriads of people who have good reputations, who would kind of think, hey, we might be in line to be the first hearers of this good news. But of all those people, God chose those who are among the lowliest to announce the birth of Jesus to. That is simply amazing, and it is incredible news for us. But that's not really even the heart of the story today, even though it adds a richness and a depth to it that we need to get hold of and appreciate. The heart of the message today is what the shepherds heard the angel tell them about Jesus. And we're going to slow everything down and look closely and think seriously about this as we wrap this all together. He says, do not be afraid, for I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. And then he says, today in the city of David, there's been born for you a Savior. If we could stop and think about that just for one or two moments together. A Savior. One who saves. The Messiah. The Deliverer. The hope. It's been born for you. A gift has been given to you. God has taken note. And God has intervened. And God has stepped into the world. All that hitting human brains just like yours. I mean, people just like you. Different culture, different time, absolutely. But they are human beings just like you, respond just like you to things, have surprised emotions, get confused, bewildered. All that just like you. So then they hear all this news, and then the angels erupt into this declaration. We say the angels were singing here. They're not necessarily singing. It doesn't say they were singing. It says they began declaring, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among men with whom he is pleased. Why are the angels so excited, if you would say it that way? Don't they know this is coming? I mean, weren't they all on the inside track on this? Why are the angels erupting in this chorus of declaration of glory to God in the highest? Because they're seeing something transpire in a much greater way, but in not too different of a way that as I watched Marie Brockstrom enter into the glory of heaven. They were watching salvation descend upon earth, the gift being given, the darkness being broken, the bondage being lifted, and slaves being set free, death being pushed back and illuminated by life. They were watching this massive movement of God, and it causes the angels to erupt with this great praise to God, glory to God on the highest, and on earth there can be peace among men with whom God is truly pleased. See, the angels and the glorious light and everything that took place that night that the shepherds heard this, all of that took place. It only served to hold up and illuminate the absolute glory of God's perfect, perfect salvation that he was bringing to the entire world that night. Just the shepherds, the entire world, born for you, to all people. The reason the angels were shouting glory to God in the highest was because of the staggering goodness of God that was on display. Here's where I'm getting going with this. God, in this moment that we're looking at in this story, has supplied everything we've needed to be forgiven of our sins, and to receive His gift of eternal life in heaven. God has supplied it all. It's all done. It's all completed. The gift has been offered. There's nothing left for us to do. The Bible says it like this: there is now, therefore, no condemnation left for those who are in Christ Jesus. Those who have taken hold of the gift of eternal life, this complete gift, all that's there, everything, the totality of it, the permanence of it, there's no condemnation left. There's nothing left for anybody to do to earn it, to keep it, or to measure up for it. It's been supplied. It's all there. And I think that we are easy, we get this easy at the moment of salvation. That as we're explaining how a person can come into relationship with God, and we explain to that person there's nothing you can do to earn this gift, we explain to that person there's nothing you can do to be good enough to merit it, you can't pay it back, you just got to take it as a gift. We get that. And then we're born again, and we're saved from sin, we're forgiven, and we believe that God has given us a home in heaven, literally a home in heaven. It's strange how easily I could say that without the magnitude of it gripping my heart. We're given all of this. All of this majesty, all of this glory. And then something strange happens to so many of us as we start plodding through life and we function differently over a period of time. And by that, I just mean this, is we stop celebrating and relishing this complete, perfect gift of salvation. And some reason, we start trying to earn it and to measure up to it. You know, God has supplied it for us, and then we try to earn it. So here, listen to this. This Christmas, this very moment in history, this point in that huge span of life that you have, that's really, really brief, actually. But this moment, right here and right now, offers you the chance to be swept up into a life of celebration, a life of true freedom, a life marked by joy, excitement, adventure, and purpose. And I didn't say one of those words accidentally. Every one of them very intentional. I want you to look at those words with me just a minute and just see, compare your life, mark your life alongside of them. Is your life marked with a sense of celebration for salvation? That is, when's the last time you thought with great enthusiasm and joy and appreciation in terms of saying, wow, I cannot believe this, but I have salvation. The worst the world can throw at me is death, physical, and that's taken care of. I can celebrate. Is your life marked by freedom? Are you free from guilt and shame and the obligation to perform for God or others? Are you free in your spirit? Do you have joy that marks you, that begins to be your countenance and not just your function as you go from good circumstance to good circumstance, but joy that ebbs and flows into your heart, that pulses in your life, that becomes a reputation of who you are? Is there joy in your life or excitement? When's the last time you met somebody who was excited, truly excited about life, not a circumstance in life, but life itself? You can be swept up into a life that is marked by excitement, because there is nothing more exciting than following Jesus and knowing Jesus in this life, free from the guilt and condemnation that sin brings, a life of adventure. You know what? I speak directly to guys here. There are so many guys that think that following Jesus is about calming down, shaping up, and behaving, that you just think this has got to be the most boring thing on earth. And you can even imagine some guys saying, I don't want to go to heaven and sit on a cloud and play a harp. That would just kill me. In fact, that would sound like punishment, because that's not really true, right? No one ever said you're going to sit on a cloud anywhere. And Lord knows that I can't play a harp. And that would not be beautiful to anybody. Has God called you to boredom? To a sterile, emotionless, adventureless life? No, God has called you to a salvation that leads you and ushers you into the greatest adventure you're ever going to know, called following Jesus by faith. So when you go to the school that you go to the workplace that you go to a hospital, you go to a wedding, or you go anywhere, to your neighbor, to your home, did you know that you can live a life that is marked by adventure? What could you have that would mark more, that would bring more adventure into your life than simply saying this: God, wherever you go, I'm going with you. You supply all I need and I'll follow you. There is more adventure in the life of following Christ than you could possibly imagine or tap into. And then a life of purpose, a life of true purpose, knowing why you're here. You know how important that is? To wake up and know that your life has a purpose here beyond what you do for a paycheck. You may go there and do what you do and have to do that, and that's a good thing, but your purpose has nothing to do with what your career choice is. Your purpose is played out in your career choice. You can do that. God can offer you that. But listen, it will not happen. That life is not possible if you want to walk around and think and begin to think that salvation is almost complete. But I'm going to tell you that salvation is complete. What the shepherds heard that night is salvation has come. It hasn't started, but it has come. The gift has been offered. It's complete and it's total. The only thing you can do in response to this offer of salvation is to accept it by faith. Now listen, please, listen closely. There is a dangerous thing. It's an epidemic in the church. It's an epidemic among Christians to get saved by grace, to get it, to really be born again, to do that. And then begin somewhere on the journey, somewhere on this pathway with God, we get off track and start believing that the salvation we were given as a gift must now be earned and kept by being a good person and doing good things for God. Do you hear what I'm saying? See, I think I'm talking to a lot of people here this morning who started right. Place your faith in Jesus for the salvation that you know He offers. And then somewhere along the journey, by the enemy's tactics, the very devil's schemes in our life, is to get us off the freedom, off the joy, off the adventure, off the purpose, off the excitement, all of that, and begin to make us start feeling like and thinking like we got to work to maintain our salvation. So we do that by trying to be better people, thinking that if I am a better person, I will keep my standing with God intact, thinking that if I do these things, God does these things. And it's a barter system. Did you know the entire book of Galatians was written to people who got off track like that? The whole book of Galatians written to people who started by faith in Jesus and then thought they could be kept by their works. Let me read you just one portion of that passage in Scripture. In Galatians chapter 2, or chapter 3, I'm sorry. Galatians chapter 3, I'm going to read it out of the New Living Translation. And here's what it says, starting in verse 2 through verse 5. He says, "Let me ask you this one question," Paul says to the Galatian church. "Did you receive the Holy Spirit by obeying the law of Moses, that is, keeping the law or doing good works? Did you get saved by doing good works?" Of course not. He said, "You received the Spirit," that is another phrase for salvation. You were saved because what? Because you believed the message you heard about Christ. You didn't get saved by being good people. You didn't get saved by keeping the law. You got saved because you believed the message about Jesus, that He came and lived and died a sinless life, that He was crucified for your sins and raised to eternal life. You believed that. You were born again, received the Spirit. Verse 3 says, "How foolish can you be? After starting your Christian lives in the Spirit, starting by salvation by grace, why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort?" How did you get off track like this? How did you start by grace and end up with works? Why did you do that? Verse 4 says, Have you ever experienced so much for nothing? Surely it was not in vain, was it? Listen to verse 5. He says, "I ask you again." Starting in verse 2, he said, "Let me ask you this question." Verse 5, he says, "Let me ask you one more time. Does God give you the Holy Spirit and work miracles among you because you obey the law?" Church, you listen, please, quickly, focus. I'm going to ask you Paul's question. So I'm going to read it, but I'm going to read it for you to listen, not to just hear and understand, but I want you to hear it as if the Apostle Paul has echoed this across eternal distance from his day to today, saying this: does God give you the Holy Spirit and work miracles among you because you obey the law and are a good person? Did God save you? because you were a good person? Did God save you because you're benevolent, because you're nice, because you've never killed anybody, because you haven't committed adultery, because you have more good than bad? Did God save you for those reasons? Of course not. It's because you believe the message you've heard about Christ. There is nothing to celebrate about a salvation that you have to earn or keep, because there is no such thing as a salvation that you can earn or keep. Listen to me, please, closely. I know we're done. There is nothing to celebrate about a salvation that you think you've got to keep in the balance. That is something to dread and fear. The salvation that the shepherds heard about is a gift that's been totally, completely supplied for you, and all you do is receive it by faith. That sounds too simple, right? We got to do something. Come on. We can't just take that gift by faith. Parents, let me ask you this question then. When your kids, when you give them the best gift you can possibly afford to give them, or the best gift you think that they need for Christmas, whatever it is, do you want them to open that gift and say, thank you, Mommy and Daddy, thank you, thank you, thank you. What could I ever do to repay you? You didn't give them to them so they could get, you could get something back, did you? You didn't. Wouldn't it be tragic if you saw a 10-year-old little girl or a 10-year-old little boy take that gift and celebrate it and say, Mommy and Daddy gave this because they love me, but I wonder if they gave this to me because they really want me to be a better person. Oh, I better start trying. I better start listening better and cleaning my room more and eating more of my vegetables and doing this and doing that. And then they wore themselves out, become a different child altogether almost. And you ask them why and say, why are you, you know, son, daughter, why are you doing this? Well, you gave me such a good gift, I thought I had to try really hard. How many of you are in that trap today with your father who offered you a salvation free and complete? All you had to do is receive it. All you have to do is reach out, take hold of it. Yeah, turn from your old life, turn to the new life. Repent of sin and turn, place your faith in Jesus. Absolutely, but it didn't say anything about trying to mark the rest of your steps with a good performance for a father who thinks that, who's somehow judging you constantly. There's no condemnation left for you in this salvation, none. If you're in the grip of guilt and shame and boredom or disillusionment with God, you can start over today. Did you know that? Some of you need so desperately to start over today because you are just as bored with your relationship with God. Oh, you probably like church. You come and sing the songs and like the people, but if you know you put you and God in a room, you wouldn't have anything to say. You're either angry or in disbelief or disillusionment or just bored and don't ever think about that. You know, you can regain the adventure and the passion of your relationship with God today if you will take salvation back. Not that you ever lost it, but get hold of it again in terms of it's a gift given by grace. You don't have to earn it. It's not a tightrope He's asking you to walk on. So to answer the question that we started off with, we can truly celebrate God's salvation as a lifestyle when we realize, when we get hold of, it's His salvation given to us completely as a gift and not as a reward. Did you know your salvation is a gift and not a reward? That's why this baby in a manger is so powerful. That's why we can celebrate the baby in His coming, because the baby was the Messiah. The baby was the gift. It's here. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven has come upon you. He didn't say it was coming. He said it came. It had come. It had arrived and was going to continue to arrive and wash up on our lives like the tides of the ocean. Here is your challenge, and I want you to do this with me. I just thought of this late, and I really want us to engage this at some level, certainly tweak it to where it works for you. But this Christmas Eve or Christmas morning, whoever you're with, whenever you begin to do your opening of gifts, exchanging of gifts, I want to ask you to just take some time, especially speak to dads, if you can lead your homes to do this. But it doesn't matter if it's, you know, if there's not a dad present, obviously this is certainly not preclusive to you. But take some time to let people talk about what it means to them to celebrate Jesus as Savior, as complete, total, perfect Savior. Let people try to wrestle with putting that into words. It's okay if a 10-year-old can't put great words to that, but let's let them try. Let's let adults wrestle with this. What does it mean to celebrate Jesus as Savior this Christmas. If you look back over the last year, what has it meant to you, or what have you come to realize about that saving relationship? And then, after you have just a brief period of discussion, it doesn't have to be long or anything, just try to ask people to wrestle with that thought and that concept. Then after that, let every gift that is open be a reminder of His gift of salvation to us. You don't have to say anything, but every time a gift is open, you're thinking, Jesus was a perfect gift. My salvation is complete, and every gift that I get today is a reminder of that ultimate gift. Wouldn't that be precious? I think it would be. Let's thank God for our salvation. Lord God, not everybody in this room has accepted that gift, and some are still struggling, thinking they have to earn it. Never received it because they never felt like they were worthy. And Father, I pray that You would reveal to them that they're not, and no one ever has been, worthy. You don't give it to us for that reason. You give it to us because You loved us perfectly. And I pray that there would be great freedom wash over their spirit and their heart today to know that the gift is offered to them, just as it was offered to the shepherds, just as they were the first to hear the news and proclaim the news, that we could be included and swept up into that marvelous story. Change us. And this Christmas, I pray that we wouldn't just tear into gifts and be excited about stuff that's not going to last long. We'd be most excited about Jesus. Because that gift of Jesus, Father, keeps getting newer. The day keeps dawning brighter. The darkness keeps fading. And hope begins to dawn more and more in our lives. And we can celebrate that. And Father, maybe the challenge that I gave just sparks another thought in people's lives, and there would be great creativity and freedom among our congregation to let the traditions and the material process of our celebration of Christmas take on new meaning in creative and exciting ways that would mark a great celebration in our lives for our great salvation that You've given us. And we love You. God, and I'm very mindful today that the only reason I could possibly love You is because You loved me first. So I love You back. Lord, thank You for my precious little boy, Griffin, who loves to play I Love You Most. And I'm reminded every time he does that You're doing that with me. Oh, You do. God, I give up. You do. You love me most. I thank You for teaching me to love You back. In Jesus' name, amen. I've explained everything I need to explain to you about what salvation is. And if you want to talk to somebody about entering a relationship with God, hey, we will do that. And maybe you just need to wrestle with that concept for just a few minutes and not hear my voice echoing in your head. So we're just gonna be quiet and let the musicians play, and you can respond. If you want to come talk to me, man, I'll be right here. I'll just be sitting right here and tap me on the shoulder and we'll go talk, or I'll pray with you, or we can just say, hey, I want to grab you after the service and talk, okay? You want to grab somebody else in the worship service and say, listen, would you pray with me? Would you talk with me? I just need some answers, or at least need to be able to ask some questions. Maybe you need to seal something down with God and say yes, okay? During this time, you can do that, all right? Let's just pray and reflect as God leads us through.
Light of the world, You step down into darkness and open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore You. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that You're my God. You're altogether lovely, and altogether worthy, and altogether wonderful to
good. That is good. Hey, I want to do something. I did this first service, and it was not planned then, so it's not really planned now. I want to do something I think is important. And that is, if you are a person who would be willing, you would just be willing to talk to another person who is struggling with legalism, or they feel trapped in a performance-based relationship with God. If you'd be the person that just listen to them and love them and pray for them, it's okay if no one stands up. That's okay. It's not a bad thing. I'll just tell you, we had like 6 or 7 people stand up in the first service, so if you're all going to catch up to them, you have to at least beat that. But seriously, if you would just be willing to have a conversation with somebody who says, I just need to talk to just a real person about my real struggles. You don't have to have all the answers. You don't have to have all the Bible responses. You just got to love somebody. If you'd be willing to have that conversation with somebody, I'm going to ask you to stand up right now. Would you do that? If you'd just be willing to have that kind of conversation with somebody. Okay? Now, I'm going to ask everybody else, while you stay standing, look around you. Everybody look around so it's not awkward for just one person. Just look around and see those faces, those people. Okay? All right, you be seated. Here's what I'd love to see happen. Just in the hallways after church, you'd grab one of those people and just say, I would like to talk to you. I don't know you, but you stood up in that service, and I'm really, you know, what the pastor was talking about, I get it, but I don't know how to get out of this. And listen, I'll be glad to talk to you too, but I think there's really, really something powerful when you get somebody who's not the preacher to share the journey with you. I think that would be good, okay? I am more than willing to. In fact, I love it. If I feel like a relationship hog sometimes, but so I'm trying to share, and I want you to take advantage of that, okay? Hey, we're going to finish up our worship service with our offering. It's not an addendum or an afterthought. This is about giving because we get to give. Well, that sounds like a manipulative backdoor way to get people to give a lot of money, doesn't it? I'm not trying to do that. But we give to things that matter to us. We give our time and our energy and our resources to things that count, things that we feel like are worthy of sacrifice. And I'm just going to tell you that we're not here trying to build a bigger building. We're not here trying to have a fancier facility or to get raises for staff. We're here really trying to engage a mission. And we mess up. We don't do it all well perfectly. Okay, so there's no pretension there. But I think we're aiming in the right direction. And so we call for your generous and unbridled support in every way, with your time and your energy and with your finances. So we ask you to give with generosity, knowing this, that your leaders are doing their very best jobs human beings know how to do, to be good stewards of the money so that we could advance the mission, all right? So we ask you to give in that light. Roger, would you pray for our offering today?
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time in the service that we can give back. And Father, as we place our tithes and offerings in the plate and as it come by, Father, let us give it with a cheerful attitude. And Father, help us as a church to use it to benefit the things that you would have us to do. And Father, just guide and direct us to use it to increase your kingdom. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
The skies of Bethlehem appear to star, while angels sang to lonely shepherds. 3 wise men seeking truth traveled from afar, hoping to find the child from heaven. Falling on their knees, they bowed before the humble Prince of Peace. And I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you.
Yeah. See Mike right there? He's an answered prayer. Not because he's here on staff, but because he's here at all, all right? Because he's not feeling great. But you know what? You look worse when you started and you look better now. He had no color earlier. He was kind of that color. It was a little troubling. I didn't think he was going to make it, but thank you for praying for him. I know we've been praying for you. You're feeling about the same, but you have more color in your cheeks. That's good. Because you got to do the music now. You got to practice for Christmas Eve. Y'all be nice to him, all right? Get him stuff. Tell him you love him. Tell him he's awesome. Prop him up. Let's not go that far. All right. Hey, be praying for our worship services on Christmas Eve, 5:30 and 7 o'clock. Pray for those. Not just that people would come, but that it would be what God wants it to be. All right? We don't want to do a Christmas Eve service just to have a Christmas Eve service, right? We don't want to do that. We want it to honor Jesus and to be focused on Jesus. We want you to walk in here and feel gripped by His grace and the presence of His Spirit. So would you pray along those lines? Pray passionately, unceasingly, that would be a great movement of worship that night, a chorus of worship and celebration, all right? So please do that. And yeah, absolutely, invite 10 or 15 of your closest neighbors to come with you and be a part of it. We'll have those two services. Please plan on being here. We celebrate tonight, that night, in a great way, all right? Hey, there's other stuff in here. You can read the bulletin. We'd love for you to do that. And we're going to let you go today. And we're thankful that you made it here today safely. So let's be thankful you made it home safely. Drive well. Pray for each other. God bless you. We'll see you Christmas Eve.